Hello YouTube. In this video, we're going to look at a very unique tape recorder made by 3M Wollensak. It dates from approximately 1963-64. It was not a very big seller at the time. It's very rare to see today. Occasionally you'll see some of these on eBay. This machine was 3M's attempt at making a budget tape recorder. I was originally contacted by the owner. His name was Bob, and I was going to restore it for him, but I ran into so many problems with this machine that what I wound up doing was I sent him an Emerson tape recorder, the one that I have called the tape recorder from Mars, which you can see on YouTube. If you look up Mars tape recorder ClydeSight, you will find that machine. That's what I sent to my client Bob, because I could not get this to work. But I just couldn't leave it alone. I just had to find out why I was having all the problems with it. So in this video, you're going to learn things about what to look for in a record play switch, how that can fail and looks like it's perfectly fine. You're going to see how a motor mounting system can fail and what you need to do to make that work. And you're going to also see how most of the time when you're chasing down hum, you're looking for a loose ground, but there's a second part to that equation. Sometimes you have to look for something called a ground loop. So that's part of what plagued this machine. So stay tuned to the video, and you're going to see it from unpacking through restoration. I hope you enjoy it. This is Robert's original packaging. Here's a tip: because this is packaged so tightly in the box, it's hard to reach in and pull it out. So what I've done is I've turned the whole thing upside down, and now I can lift the box. Right off the tape recorder. We're looking at the underside of it. There's a little bit of white stuff from the foam, of course, the styrofoam. We can see that the plate is removable. The bottom plate is removable by screws located here. And it says that this cover is provided with an electrical interlock. So obviously this is a tube type machine, because in the old days you used to take the covers off, replace the tubes, and then that way you could get in, and to make it safe, they put the interlock on. Let's take a look here, which is the front of the machine. See here, this is the original vinyl covering. It's in pretty bad shape. This is all just, oh, awful. Look at this. It's all rotted. The glue let go. It all curled up. Who knows what happened to that? Bob did say that he had gotten this machine on eBay, that was a problem. Here we see the speaker. We see some more. This is all rotted. This probably should just be removed. It's so useless the way it is. Here it is on the back. Same thing, rotting. This can't be repaired. This just has to be taken off. And another covering put on, because it's just totally gone. I've never seen cosmetics quite this bad. And then again, here is the same thing. So that's pretty bad. And here is the control surface for it, and here's where the reels go. And Robert did put in the Wollensak manual, which is very helpful. And I've been through the manual, and I see how the machine works. This is basically a modified T-1500. Has a few different features on it, most of which is this four-speed drive. Let's take a look at the controls. First we see the volume control and the tone control. The volume is also the on-off switch. There is an indicator here that says normal, another indicator that says distort. These are two little light bulbs, it looks like. I looked in the manual, they're just little indicators. They flash to indicate that what's going on. Here is the record switch. You pull it over this way to lock the record in position. In the center here we have a button that says play record, player record, stop, and pause. So to put the machine into play or record, you push like that. If you want to push pause, you push pause like that and just hold it down, and it pulls the pinch roller away from the head slightly. And it's very hard to move. It's very stiff. And then to stop, you just use that. So basically what the thing does to pause is it half stops. Now here is a speed control, and this is 15/16, and it's apparently some kind of an interlock. So you pull it out and then to the next one. I think it probably the motor has to be turned on in order to check it. Here we have a rewind fast forward lever, just like in the T-1500s. Now this is interesting. Watch these. I put it in rewind and notice that this moves this way and this moves this way. So it's on a rocking arm. And then when I do it, it goes the opposite way. So the way this is working, and I've seen it in the manual and we'll take a look at it, each of these has a tire on it, and as this gets rocked either way, it swings the idlers up against probably the capstan flywheel. So the next step is to turn it on and see what it does. Alright, we're ready to turn it on. We can hear, you can hear that sound. Let's see if it rewinds or fast forwards. Okay, nothing's happening in fast forward. Nothing's engaged. Nothing's happening in rewind. This tells me something is not engaging. Just nothing is happening here. Let's try play. Is anything happening in play? Nothing is happening in play that I can see either. Let's see if I switch this out. Can I change the speed? It does not like changing speed. I'm going to have to find out what's going on there. So I don't want to force it. So the next step is we're going to have to take this apart and take a look at why this is not, nothing is spinning on this. It's weird. All right, I have to show this upside down just simply because of the way the machine is arranged. This is the head cover. It's got a little tab on it that sits under this slot here, like that, and then these two screws hold it in place. So I remove this, and we can see the capstan assembly and the record playhead, and it's a combination erase record playhead similar to what other Wollensak machines used, and it's a plug-in type. Similar to what other Wollensak machines use. So it's a, basically this is, again, it's a simplified version of what we already have seen. And here is the capstan shaft, and the flywheel obviously is underneath there, and it is spinning freely, so the it means that it doesn't, the idler is not engaged, the motor idler is not engaged. And when I push the speed control over, it still is, it's partially engaged, so there's something stuck there. And that's why it's not catching. Okay, I got the machine to start. The problem was that the speed control was all jammed here. This is the weirdest thing. The way this speed control works, this plate has to be on because this is the locking mechanism for the speed control. It raises and lowers the motor. I'll show you that much later on. But at least I got it to run. So now when I turn on the power here, you can hear, and it needs quite a bit of lubrication, goes into fast forward, goes into rewind, and put it into play, and the capstan turns, but the belt is just totally shot on this, so that's why this take-up reel is not working. Now I'm going to try it. See, it slips and it drops down to this position, and then it just absolutely will not do anything at all. This needs quite a bit of work. This is an extensively bizarre project. What we're seeing here is this is the amplifier. for the tape recorder, and then this is the power supply. There's a very huge power transformer under here, and there's a fuse here. This is the motor, and the way the speed control works, this is the most bizarre thing I've ever seen. Instead of moving the idler up and down on the speed on the motor pulley, the motor itself moves up and down. That's why this thing was jamming, so I have to find out how this is working. It's the most bizarre thing I've ever seen. Here we see the capstan flywheel, and it's a hollow flywheel. In other words, it's very much like a record turntable. And the flywheel is what turns the take-up and rewind table for fast-forward and rewind. These are mounted in a bar here, and there must be something similar underneath here. This is absolutely the weirdest thing I've ever seen, the motor assembly. And you can see now that since I've freed up the motor, you can see it's moving the capstan flywheel. You see that? See that turning there right here? You notice that hole? The motor for the Wollensak T-524 is the weirdest thing I've ever seen in a tape recorder. For some reason, instead of allowing the mechanism to move up and down on the pulley, which is here, they decided to move the whole motor up and down and keep the pulley fixed. Why they made that choice, I don't know, but because of that, they had to build this very bizarre motor mount. Now, the back of the motor is interesting in that we have the four-bladed fan for cooling, and then there's this stem that sticks out. The stem serves no purpose. There's no indication in the service manual why it's there, but it doesn't matter because the motor never sits on the back end anyway. Instead, it hangs from this plate here by three bolts. Now, the bolts themselves are fused to the motor housing. You can see one there. And they come up through this rubber grommet, and then this is the top part, and this washer is just to stabilize it. Same thing here and in the other place. So those are the, that's the way the thing hangs from this plate. Now the plate has legs on it. There's one, here's another one, and there's a third one, and those legs mount to the frame of the tape recorder, or the top plate of the tape recorder. Everything hangs from the top plate. And this is the speed control, and it is connected to this cross brace here. You see it's hinged here and it's hinged here, so that you see how that moves like that. Now, when this thing is mounted properly, instead of this moving, you can see the arms go with it. Instead of that moving, obviously, the motor will be moving. And that's how they change speeds on this thing. It's very, very strange. I'm not quite sure what Wollensak was thinking of, but the way it works is there's two plates. Now, we see a bottom plate here. I'm pointing to it here and under here and so on. And there are posts here and here and here, and this plate hangs from the upper deck plate. If we look at it from underneath, you can see the structure of the plate here. You see how it's made and it's formed and everything. And this whole assembly hangs literally from the main deck of the tape recorder, which means it's kind of like a sandwich. The capstan flywheel gets sandwiched in between these two plates. It has a bearing in the back with a ball bearing, and then there's a bearing that comes down here. And this is just a washer to help, keep things from being noisy and so on. So the entire mechanism basically is here for the fast-forward, the rewind, and the take-up. Now, this is bizarre how this works. And we're going to close in on here. Take a look at this. There is a bar underneath these two spindles or tables, and it runs across, and it's got a pivot on it underneath here. This arm here has a pivot here and a fork, so that as this turns, it causes this to turn. Now watch. You see how it rocks back and forth? So this is how they managed to get the fast forward and rewind to work. When this bar is pushed to the left, it pulls the feed table down against the capstan flywheel. When it's pushed to the right, it pulls the take-up table down through an idler to the capstan flywheel. And the reason the idler is there is just to change the directions, because the flywheel always turns in this direction, and as a result, this will go in this direction, which is correct for rewind, and the same thing happens here, and so this does the fast forward. Now, in the meantime, we've got a fixed post here, and there are eccentric holes cut in the two brake levers, so that as this rocks, it uses the geometry of the eccentric hole to move the brakes off the tires located here and here. And on top of that, these tires are not fixed to the drums. Instead, they're pressure fit, but underneath each tire there is a band of what looks like some kind of silicone, so that the tires can actually slip. Now there's a belt here that goes from a pulley underneath the flywheel here to a pulley here, which is part of the take-up clutch mechanism. Here we're looking at the take-up clutch mechanism. Now the belt from the capstan drives this pulley, which is a free pulley, but it has a piece of, well, it's almost like sandpaper on the underside of it there, and then there's this piece of foam that they made, and then the table itself has a piece of sandpaper, so the foam gets stuck between the two pieces of sandpaper, so as this spins, it tries to turn the foam, which tries to turn the upper table. And that's how they make it work. And just like in all of the Wollensaks, there is an elevator here. So watch it go up and down. Very slight motion. This is the way that handles. This is the other end of that rocking arm. And you see how it moves? And there's a post from the upper deck that goes down into here, and that moves it. There's also a flange from the upper deck, which we'll look at in a minute, that hits these two plates here to move the brakes out of the way for play. But for rewind and fast forward, that's how the brakes get shifted. The rocking actually makes it move. It's simple, but it's clumsy again because it's sandwiched. The flywheel itself is rather surprising because it is almost 7 inches in diameter. This is a 7-inch reel. In the service manual, there was a, what do they call it, a memo or a notice from Wollensak, where they were making a part for this flywheel called a silencer. And the reason is real simple. Listen to this. And that's called flywheel singing. And it's caused by the fact that this is so well made. It's almost like a turntable. The way it's so well made and balanced, it rings like a bell. And when the tape recorder is running, because there's an idler pressing against the edge of this from the outside, and it goes over in this area here, we'll look at it in a minute, this idler is pressing against there, any roughness in the idler will cause singing in the flywheel. And so, unfortunately, this does not have the silencing ring that Wollensak wanted to put on the machine. This is the top plate, and we can see that it's totally simple. There's nothing really to it. These mechanisms here, these arms, work with the speed controller, and it also helps lock the play switch so that it won't turn on and off when you're in fast forward or rewind. And this is this play switch here. That's all it is, just this simple rocker switch here. And when it's turned on, it simply causes this to swing forward, and if the capstan was there, it would be pressing against it, just the pinch roller, and of course it moves the pressure roller, or not the pressure roller, but the pressure pad, which does not engage the head, but rather engages the guidepost next to the head. This, I assume, is to help keep the head from wearing out. And it's the first time I've ever seen that on a tape recorder. And then to turn it off, you just simply rock the switch back the other way, and it then pulls this out of the way through a plate. Now, the mechanism we just looked at, the capstan and the brakes and the take-up tables and so on, that hangs from this deck. And we're going to look at the underside. This bar is moved by that rocker switch that we just looked at, and on the top of the bar here is a little hang-down flange. That pushes the brakes out of the way because this will go forward in the play motion and it comes back in the stop. I'll show you that now. See how it moved forward? And of course there's a spring here to bring it back into place. Now we know why there was a dimple formed in the capstan flywheel, and that's to accommodate this spring area here. This is the drive idler, and it slides back and forth on a plate, and that it has a plastic carrier. It's pretty worn out. The drive idler is pretty worn out too, and you can see that a lot of the grease is colored, discolored everything. I've cleaned up most of the grease as much as I can. I have the sandwich, which I call it, all back together. Let's take a look at the way the sandwich actually looks. And here you can see this is the bottom plate that we had looked at, the black plate. This is the rocker for the fast forward rewind. See it rocking? This is the take-up clutch mechanism. And this is the feed table. And here are the brakes. And that's basically all there is to it. Then underneath here we can see here's the capstan flywheel. And on this side, we can see here's the idler. Now, the idler rides on a track this way. And when it's here, it's totally disengaging the flywheel. But the spring makes it always try to engage the flywheel. This never moves up and down. The motor, which goes in here, in this slot here, and then the speed control goes in this slot, that's what moves up and down on the idler. So it's a very bizarre system. And then this is, of course, the lever that we got for fast forward and rewind. And here is the belt for the take-up table during play or record. That's basically how this works. You can see that the sandwich, you can see inside there a little bit. And there you can see the capstan flywheel and how close it is to the plate. The top plate, everything is very tight on this. I have the chassis mounted on these clamps here to hold it in position so I can test it before I put the whole machine together. This speed control adjustment, which is here, only works when this plate is present. So this plate has to be screwed onto the deck and the knob has to be put into place, otherwise you can't change the speed. I have a dummy plug here that I've run to the motor, so I'm going to turn it on temporarily without the amplifier. You can hear the fan, and now I can change the speeds. You see how that works? It's kind of awkward to do it in this position. And to show that it's working, you can see, there we go. We can change speeds while it's running. That's 3 3/4. There's 1 7/8. And there's the 15/16. There's the pause. And of course, because it's running, we can change it to the higher speed. There's 1 7/8. And there's 3 3/4. And then I'm not in a good position for holding this in place. And then there's that. Now, to go to fast forward, I'll just use the lever here. It's extremely fast at 7.5 inches per second. Now, the speed of the fast forward and the rewind is directly proportional to the speed here because it comes off the capstan itself. So there you can see it's slower. It's even slower. That's 1 7/8. And then this is 15/16, which is the slowest speed. And then rewind. Now there's a sound that can be heard here, and that's the friction clutch mechanism. Remember, it has that sandpaper in it. So it stops when the machine is actually playing, but you can hear it when the machine is stopped. Now we're going to take a look at the we're going to look at it from the side so we can see the mechanism. There is the stepper pulley on the motor, and I'm going to show you the motor going up and down. Now right now it's in its lowest position, 15/16. Here it is at the next position, 1 7/8. The next position, 3 3/4. And finally the top position, which is 7 1/2. So you can see how it will go down and up. Down and up. And the fan that's located here is an induction fan, so it pulls air from the outside and it blows it across the motor. So if you could have your hands here, you would feel the air coming up this direction. The T-524 has a very, very small amplifier board consisting of one 6T9 tube and a 12AX7 tube. There's another board in the case for the rectifier, which handles all of that, and then there are cables that run to this board to manage it. Here is the bias coil, and it had two of these multi-section caps, one here and one here. Now this one is two sections of 20 microfarads each, and this one is 20 and 10. And they're all rated at 300 and 350 volts. So I decided to replace these because they're not reliable. And I replaced them with modern caps made by Nichicon. So there's a 20 and a 20, and there's a 10 and a 20, and they're all rated at 400 volts. So there's plenty of extra voltage wiggle room, so they won't, they'll have less tendency to fail. So they're wired into the board, and you can see the underside of the board is exactly as it was. It's just up here that they're wired in. Now there's one extra thing that I did, and that is you can see there's a black wire that runs from this junction over to the common junction here. And that's because the bottom of the cans had three legs, and that's the can is the negative, it's the ground. And it had three legs, so it was transferring ground across three different terminal points on the board. And that's the same thing for the other can as well. So I had to make sure that there was a ground path, and that's why I did that. Now, on this side of the board, which is hidden in the back of the tape recorder when it's mounted, we see the record play switch. I cleaned the record play switch, but I did discover a serious problem when I put the amplifier back in. This is the second time I've been working on the amplifier, because the thing went dead when I put it in and tried to use it. And it wasn't the capacitors. I know it wasn't the capacitors. The reason was because of this finger right here, this third finger, that was not making contact with the plate. And it, obviously it has to make contact with the plate, because if you look at the circuit tracing, you'll find it is the hot lead from the record head. So the record playhead was not making contact with the rest of the circuitry. And when it was put in record, it also failed for the same reason. So I had to adjust this very carefully to make sure that it made contact with the plate again. If you work on Wollensak tape recorders, they all use this type of switch. Be very, very careful of these little fingers when you're cleaning the machine. I was using an artist brush to clean it, but what had happened was apparently somehow I must have gotten distracted, or somehow I knocked it, and I just knocked the finger completely off alignment. And it looked like it was under alignment, but when I looked under a magnifying glass, there was the tiniest of gaps. So I had to close up that gap. This is very important on these machines. The record play switch, if that fails, well, you have a very nice paperweight. It's a cute amplifier board, little tiny thing. No other capacitors on it. All the resistors are at the right value. I've checked it. So everything tests out fine. And this should be ready to go with no problems whatsoever. Here is the drive mechanism. Here's the capstan flywheel. Here's the drive idler. Here's the amplifier and speaker and the power supply here. And there is a hidden tube, a rectifier tube, for the power supply. We're going to listen now at 7.5 inches per second to a sample of some music recorded from a movie. This is done for the purpose of demonstrating this machine. Now there's the pause. When I push this down, it will pause. All right, I'm not going to play any more because I don't want to get in trouble with YouTube, but you can hear it plays music pretty well. What we're going to do is I'm going to flip the tape over to a blank side and I'm going to make a recording using a Wollensak microphone so you can see everything that works, and we'll make the recordings and we'll prove that this works. The inputs and outputs for the T-524 are on the back of the tape recorder here, managed by this plate that you can see. There's a switch there. When it's in the PA, it acts like a public address system. When it's in the mic, it silences the internal speaker. There's an external speaker output, which is a 1/4-inch phone jack, and then there are two inputs. One is an RCA input for the microphone, the other is an RCA input for the radio or phonograph. Now, this Wollensak microphone came from another Wollensak tape recorder of the same amplifier style, tube amplifier style. That tape recorder is long gone, and somebody sent me these microphones as a gift. That's Amberola 1B on YouTube, so thank you, Amberola 1B. It took a couple of years before I actually was able to make use of this microphone, but it does work fine. And it simply plugs in right here like that. You set your level by holding the record lever over to engage the record play switch. Then you turn your volume to about 5 or 6 and speak into the microphone, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And when you speak into the microphone, these little indicators will light up. If you are in normal range, the normal indicator will keep lighting up. And if you go over range, the distort, which is located here, will light up. These little bulbs are very dim. They're neon bulbs. And you won't be able to see them on camera, so there's no point in trying to look at it. But you can set your levels without engaging the machine. Over here is your speed control. So I've got it set to 7.5. All I have to do is hold this lever and start the machine. So here we go. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Wollensak T-524 reel-to-reel tape recorder at 7.5 inches per second. Switching speeds now to 3 3/4. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Wollensak T-524 tape recorder. Notice that I was able to change the speeds while the motor is running. You do not change speeds on this machine unless the motor is running. Changing speeds now to 1 7/8. testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We are testing the Wollensak T-524 at 1 7/8. I can change the speeds while the motor is running, both down and up, but I have to have the motor turned on to do that. Now we'll go to the final speed, 15/16. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing at 15/16 inches per second. The equalization is worst at this level. We will now go back up to 7.5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at 7.5 inches per second again. This is the end of the test. This is the end of the test. So now all I have to do is rewind, and we will be able to hear that playback. And you have to be careful because it's easy to hit this thing and knock it. It naturally wants to go this way because of the weight of the motor. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Wollensak T-524, reel-to-reel tape recorder at 7.5 inches per second. Switching speeds now to 3 3/4.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is
the Wollensak T-524 tape recorder. Notice that I was able to change the speeds while the motor is running. You do not change speeds on this machine unless the motor is running. Changing speeds now to 1 7/8. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We are testing the Wollensak T-524 at 1 7/8. I can change the speeds while the motor is running, both down and up, but I have to have the motor turned on to do that. Now we'll go to the final speed, 15/16. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing at 15/16 inches per second. The equalization is worst at this level. We will now go back up to 7.5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at 7.5 inches per second again. This is the end of the test. This is the end of the test. So you can hear the machine makes a recording, a voice recording, very well. 15/16 is a disaster. It is on almost every tape recorder I've ever used. 1 7/8, 3 3/4, and 7.5 are pretty good though. So this is a very typical Wollensak type of sound. It's a little bit tinny because this microphone is a crystal microphone. I have tested this machine with a dynamic microphone using a very bizarre sort of set of adapters. This machine is, as far as I'm concerned, a done deal. One thing I want to point out is on the case here, you'll see that we just have the metal case. I took all of that rotted cloth off and cleaned up the glue, and they had painted the case underneath nicely, so I thought, well, why bother with a cloth? It isn't necessary. Thank you for watching the video on the Wollensak T-524 reel-to-reel 4-speed monophonic half-track tape recorder. It's Wollensak's very unusual design. It is, according to one of the Wollensak technicians who is still alive, according to his writings, this was an attempt by 3M and Wollensak to make a low-budget tape recorder, and it is, whatever they did to design this, I would love to have been smoking the same stuff, because that's the weirdest design I've ever seen. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you ever encounter one of these machines, now you know how they work. I remember seeing them, the ads, and this bizarre switch, the way they made this switch. You know, it's a rocker switch, but it has these two steps on it, and of course the step is simply so that you can half stop it to create a pause. And that solved that mystery. And then this silly 4-speed mechanism. The whole machine is, it's a good machine. It's noisy. The fan is what makes the noise on the machine. So there are things that I would not have done. But overall, it is an example of Wollensak's engineering and 3M's engineering. And we have to still give credit to 3M because, in spite of the fact that this was not the best machine they ever made, it certainly was an unusual attempt at making an inexpensive machine to reach the masses with their product. Thanks for watching, and if you want to know more about vintage tape recorder videos, please visit ClydeSight channel on YouTube. Bye-bye, YouTube.